Watch your back. No, God's got it for you. Watch your back. No, God's got it for you. I don't know how much more I can do this. You're gonna have to take it for me. On the last push, literally. Stand here. Pushing the pedal. Pushing. Okay, guys, we're gonna have to start.
Let's just start the turn.
Well, good morning, everyone. It's great to see you. Good to be back here at BCF Church. If you're watching over the internet, we want to welcome you. Maybe you caught the end of that beginning with people doing exercises. We have our children with us upstairs today, so they're going to be dancing and singing and rejoicing with us as well. So whether you're at home or whether you're here, let's enter in and worship the Lord with all that is within us. Amen? Lift your hands together. Father, we thank you that you are here today to minister to us, and we are here to love you, express our love to you passionately, to sing and rejoice before you. Receive our praises. Inhabit our praises, we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you.
Yeah.
Shout. one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquers death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back again. We believe.
Yeah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How great is our God. How great thou art, great and mighty God. Glorious Lord, hallelujah. You are great, O God. We worship you, we adore you. Hallelujah, our soul sings to you, God. You are great. You are great and glorious and wonderful. We worship you this morning. We worship you, Lord. We worship you. Worship the Lord. Hallelujah. Worship. Glorious Lord. Hallelujah. You are great, O God. Bless God. Bless the Lord. Well, good morning, good day. How are you this morning? It's good to see you all here. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Welcome back, Pastor Randy and Pastor Jill. So happy to have you all. We miss you. Bless God. We're going to just have the kids come, and they're going to do the power shuffle. But while they're doing that, we welcome everyone who's joining online, everyone here. Why don't you turn around, give everybody a fist bump, a high five, tell them how great they look. Greet each one.
All right, so you can join us for the power shuffle. Here we go. Put your hands together, y'all.
I feel it in the air right now. It's all around, I see it everywhere. Yeah, it's the power. Yeah, yeah, God's power. It's the power to move and it starts. It's the power to heal your broken heart. Yeah, it's the power.
Yeah, yeah,
yeah, God's power. So don't hold back, no, don't hold still. God is here and he is real. Take four steps to the left, to the left.
Ready? One, two, three, four.
Turn it around and move to the right.
One, two, three.
Now take tiny little jumps, four to the front.
One, two, three, four.
Four jumps back, but you better look back.
One, two, three, four.
Now freeze. And everybody clap your hands. Now stop.
Don't sit down yet. Let's take it to the top. Here we go.
I feel it in the air right now. It's all around. I see it everywhere. Yeah, it's the power. Yeah, yeah, God's power.
Woo.
It's the power to move and it starts. It's the power to heal your broken heart. Yeah, it's the power. Yeah, God's power.
So don't hold back.
So don't hold back, no, don't hold still. Cause God is here and he is real. Take four steps to the left, to the left.
And one, two, three, four.
Turn it around and move to the right.
Just three times, two, three.
Now take tiny little jumps, four to the front. Four jumps back, but you better look back.
Let's do it all again right now.
Take four steps to the left, to the left.
One, two, three, four.
Turn it around and move to the right.
One, two, three.
Now take tiny little jumps, four to the front.
One, two, the front, two, the front, to the front.
Four jumps back, but you better look back. Everybody clap your hands. Now stop.
And have a seat. Great job, everyone. Good morning.
Yes, thank you. It's the power. The kids have the power. Do you have the power? Yes, we have the power. Okay, well, when you came in, you should have received a package that has a connection card in there. If you would take out that connection card and begin to complete your name and your address, your contact information, that would be great. That would be great. Those of you that are joining us online, you can go ahead and indicate in your chat box if you're a first-time guest, and we will get some information out to you. Well, we're going to take a few minutes to just go over money matters. How many of you know that money matters to you, money matters to God? He's concerned about everything that he has given each one of us. Isn't that great to know that God's love is with us to care for everything that we have concern for? Yes, wonderful. Well, today we just want to go over looking at living out our personal initiative. So how many of you, when you got saved, you made a choice to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? I know I did. Wonderful. And that was a choice. That was a personal initiative that you chose. Well, I'm just looking at how in 2 Corinthians verses 8 to 3, the people of Macedonia gave to Paul as they freely received. They received salvation and they were willing to give to Paul. And you know what? They were not going through a very good time. It was difficult for them, but they gave, and they gave liberally. So we're just looking at areas where we can choose to exercise our personal initiative on our journey with our relationship with Jesus Christ. So some of the things that we could do is we could take initiative to give to those in need. How many of you like to give to people in need? Wonderful. So that's one area. And that means initiative is planning in advance to do it. So you plan in advance, you prepare, you look for opportunities to be able to do that. And then take initiative to give to the cause of Christ so that the gospel can be furthered. Take initiative to give so that the gospel of Jesus Christ can be spread out. So how many of you know that giving, sharing the gospel in Brampton, around the world, costs money? It does. People travel, people share the gospel. It costs money. So in that, we have an opportunity to share, to take our own personal initiative, our own choices, to give into the kingdom of God. I know what I've done over the years is I've taken my income, and right from the beginning, my income comes off. What I'm giving to the body of Christ, to the church, my tithes, comes right off, and it goes right in. So that was something. It makes it so easy. And God blesses us. And not that he just blesses us with things, he blesses me with more faith. So I know that I want to add faith. I want to continue to believe God. Lord, I believe. And in actually exercising my giving, that increases my belief and my trust in God. And how many want our trust and believing in God to increase? So will you take initiative to give to those in need? Yes? Lovely. Will you take initiative to giving to the cause of Christ? Will you take initiative in giving to spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ? It is our choice. Plan in advance to do that. God bless you. We welcome Pastor Dr. Harrison and Pastor Kathleen.
Thank you. Well, we're going to take you right into family focus. Maybe the next 3-4 minutes of your time. I'm actually going to take a little bit of from my book. My newest book out is called When Love Comes Back. It talks about how to have your children fall in love with you. And today's topic, we want to talk about learning to love. And what does that mean? It may seem very simple, learning to love, but in reality, a lot of people struggle with loving. The word love is actually an emotion. And a lot of times people say, you know, I don't love you anymore, or I hate you, etc., etc. But love is an emotion. Love does not die. Love goes to sleep. And the goal is to resurrect love and to keep it alive. And the first thing we're going to talk about is learn to love without spoiling your children or spoiling your spouse. What does that mean? Sometimes we think by buying things for our kids or buying things for our spouse, we're loving them. But in reality, you are resurrecting a willpower that when a child is small, a lot of times we give in to the willpower of they want certain things and we buy it for them. And when they become an adult, they develop that same protocol in their mind because in the mind, I talk a little bit about the fact of what we register in our mind, that's how we live. And in reality, when you buy gifts and all, it is good, but love is not based on that gift.
The second thing is we can be friends but still be a parent first. So we can be good friends with each of our children without crossing the line of parenting. And some parents can be friends to their children, but they have a hard time drawing the line. We can share as parents too much information with our children that they feel responsible for our lives. But no, we need to open a line of communication with their children as friends where they can be open and sharing with us information and feel safe and comfortable in doing so. We like to consider ourselves best friends with our children, including our son-in-law. And we love to laugh and just have fun time together, but also time where we can cry together, share information, you know, and be open. But still, at the end of all that, we are still first parents to them.
And then we need to learn how to respect as well as listen. And sometimes that may be challenging at times because we seem like we can tune people out. But we need to learn to listen and respect our children and our spouse as well. That means that we don't pass judgment on them or wrongful judgment on them. We need to learn why people do what they do and learn to accommodate people and help them to rise up. And that goes with our children as well as our spouse. We don't put our finger and point at problems. We learn to address problems.
The next one is open room policy. What does that mean? Well, we want to be able to be open with our children in every area. We have passwords to computers and cell phones as needing, letting our children know that we care about the websites they visit, that there may be those that will stalk them over the phone or the web. We talk about abductions, kidnapped children, and the reason why safety is number one on our list. Why am I mentioning this? Well, our children see that we love them even more when we're concerned about their safety. I've had children or friends of my daughter's or son that say, you know, my parents don't really care about what time I come home. They don't care where I am. So children really love to know that our parents care about them and the safety comes first.
With the open room policy, they're also to consider that you need to develop a protocol in your house that you are still in control of your home. And that means that you need to visit your child's room as often as possible. We usually have once a month or so. I'll tell the kids I'll be visiting. And what that means is they need to pull their room together, clean up their room together. Or else I take a broom and I sweep everything in a pile and then they have to come and kind of sort out everything. So they like to clean up their room. They also we had a friend whose child was kidnapped. So we teach our children with the open door policy why we want to know what's happening in their lives so that they don't fall into the trap and if they do what they need to do as a result of that. And lastly, we also need to learn how to express how you feel. It's very important. We talk a lot about that. Love is something that needs to grow and it needs to come alive. And in doing that, we need to express it by loves and hugs and kisses and sharing emotions as well. At this time, we wanted you to turn your attention to the screen. We have a short video for you. God bless you.
Great time worshiping God today, but I'm here to invite you to register for Reveal Women's Conference. In just a few short weeks, we'll be gathering together. We've got great speakers coming to share God's word with us. We've got lots of fun events planned for you, and of course, many beautiful free gifts that you won't want to miss out on.
So watch your words.
That's for the ladies, not the men. Let's use the microphone.
I'm not turned on. Sorry. I'm sure you heard me anyway.
Yeah. Praise the Lord. Well, it's great to be back with you. As many of you know, Jill and I were on vacation for the last couple of weeks, and we had the privilege of traveling down into the Caribbean a little bit and see nice warm beaches. How many like those? Everybody does. How about you watching over the internet? You can send us text messages if you want. But I want to welcome Pastor Andy and Anne-Marie Homer from Trinidad. Would you stand up, please? We just welcome you and we salute you as wonderful leaders in the open Bible churches throughout Trinidad. God bless you. Well, lots of exciting things happen around here, and some of them are wonderful, but others are challenging as well. So we're going to spend some time praying in a little while. But before we do that, I want to recognize all of those that have birthdays or anniversaries, wedding anniversaries, during the month of October. So maybe it's past, or maybe it's still the few days ahead. But if you have a birthday, would you stand on your feet, please? We're going to pray for you. Others will be standing. If you have your wedding anniversary, we want you to stand up as well. And we're not going to just clap for you. 25th wedding anniversary. All right, good. But we want to stretch our hands out and pray for you. Would that be all right? Just stretch your hands out towards these friends. And Lord, if there's some over watching over the internet, bless them as well. But we pray for everyone that had a birthday this month, or we'll have one throughout October. We just pray for you to bless them, strengthen them, Let your presence be tangible to them. Help each and every one of them know how much you love them, care for them, and Lord, are involved in their life. Bless them with another wonderful year to serve you. And Lord, for the couples that have been married and now are celebrating another anniversary together, Lord, let your love, grow inside of them, that as they become closer to you, they become closer to one another. Help them in their relationship to be strong in the Lord and the power of your might. Lord, let them walk in the center of your will together for them, we pray. Not just today, but throughout another year of serving you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. Thank you. We also, a few things we want to pray about. How many knew we had an election here while we were gone? Did y'all vote? Voted before we left, so that was good. And we're going to put a picture of all the ones that were successful in their candidacy. Do we have any? We've invited the members of parliament, the newly minted ones, to come just so we could pray for them. And so it's not about whether we voted for these members or not. That's not the key. The Bible says that we should pray for those who are in leadership in our nation, in our city. And so we want to do that. And we're going to commit ourselves to be able to pray for them, cooperate with them, speak well of them. Is that true?
Yes.
All three of you. So, Father, we pray for these ones that have been successful. We pray for our new prime minister. We pray, Lord, that you'd give him wisdom and understanding beyond his years. We pray, Lord, that you'd surround him with men and women that love you with all their hearts. Holy Spirit, reveal Jesus to him fresh and new. Help him to understand your will and your ways. And help him lead a caucus, lead a whole group, to lead our nation. So that we can serve you with gladness. All of these local MPs that have won, we pray blessing upon them, upon their household. Keep them, Lord. Bring them into and keep them in the center of your will. We pray, Lord, for our mayor here, Linda Jeffrey. We pray for your blessing upon her and our council locally. We ask that you would lead us and guide us in the name of Jesus. Amen. And then, you know, there's some that have been sick among us. And we're taking a little more time to pray today. But there's some in hospital. Brother McLeod is in hospital now. Patrick Lee and Yoklin are on their way back very soon from Malaysia. He's been a little ill there. And so maybe there's some here today that are sick in your body. Would you stand if you are? We just want to join our faith with you. We're also going to pray for those in the Philippines that are caught in northern Luzon where the torrential rains have been. And imagine over a meter of rain falling in just a short period of time. So much flooding going on there. So, Father, we pray for these that are not well in their bodies. We know that healing is the children's bread. So we stretch our hands out to them to release the healing power of God into each and every one of these dear ones here. Lord, even some over the internet watching, we pray for health and healing into their lives in Jesus' name. Into Brother McLeod and Patrick as he travels. So, Father, we boldly declare that healing is your provision for us. Jesus, you took the stripes on your back that you may purchase healing for each and every one of us. We receive it now in the name of Jesus. We rebuke every spirit of infirmity, sickness, and disease now in the name of Jesus and command them to go from these ones in Jesus' name. And Lord, we pray for those over in Philippines that are in the midst of the downpours and the floods, and help our partners over there, but help your people to be able to receive your help, your provision, and your strength. And Lord, we pray for the persecuted church around the world. We pray, Lord, that you'd raise them up strong and bold in their faith. Let them stand fearlessly before opposition. But Lord, let your angels be around about them as well, keeping them safe and well. We pray for the grace of God to be upon them in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you. Thank you. It's a fun time we live in, isn't it? Is it all right to pray like that in a church? I think that's okay. We don't mind. We want to join our faith with one another. That's what being part of a church family is all about. You can be a believer all by yourself, but you're not as strong by yourself as we are corporately together. That's why God says that we should never forsake the assembling of ourselves together. In fact, we would gather as often as we can together and honor him, lift him up first, and then receive from him. So, you know, I know schedules are weird in Canada, people working here and there. So come as often as you can. And if you're, when we were away on vacation, we watched on the iPad over the internet down in Florida and saw the service here. So sometimes we get caught where you can't be there, but still participate and receive from God. Amen? Praise God. Well, the series we've been in is Lord, I Believe. Didn't our music team and choir do a great job singing that today? It stimulates me, gets my blood pumping when I see, yes, this is what we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus the Son. We believe this. We really believe this. It's not something that's in the Bible that's a good story. We actually believe the Bible is true. That's the foundation of the Christian church, foundation of this church. Sister Morgan, so happy to have you here. Woohoo! Praise God. Well, if you got your Bible, why don't you turn over into the book of Acts, the 27th chapter, please. And I'll just give you a little introduction while you're turning there. Or you can turn on your devices that have the Bible on them, whatever's most convenient for you. Last week, Dr. Harrison did a great job on our mind, having the mind of Christ. Did you enjoy that? I listened to it yesterday and enjoyed it. And just how God can help turn our minds. Many are persecuted by the things of the past in their minds. But through Christ, you can actually have freedom to have a renewed mind. And so God is renewing us. Praise God. Hey, guys. And helping us. I guess I'm supposed to receive the offering first. Is that it? I knew there was a reason. All right. Well, part of being a believer is we believe. We believe that it's right to give and invest into the gospel work. Is that true? In the package you received earlier, you should have got an envelope like this. Pull it out. Look at it. Make sure your name's on it. If it's not, go ahead and put it on. If you're visiting with us, we make checks out to BCF Church if you'd like to give. In excess of 10 cents out of every dollar that comes in, we send to nations around the world to help them to advance the gospel of Christ. So when you give, it's good ground. We're helping out here as well with regeneration and others and just being able to add value. But God loves people that want to worship him in finances. That's what touches every area of your life. So we'll just give you a moment to be able to prepare. Come prepared today with check or cash and you still want to give, we will have giving kiosk open after the service out in the foyer so you can use your debit card or whatever you choose. But let's lift our offering envelopes before the Lord. Jill, why don't you pray for the offering today, please?
Father, we just thank you and praise you that you're such a good God. Father, that you bless our lives and you help us to live daily. And Father, as we take what you've given us and return to you what's due you, we just pray that you'll touch many people, that your kingdom shall be established, and it shall continue to grow until Jesus returns. And we'll give you all the praise and honor and glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Ushers, could you serve us, please? We even have some of our junior highs and high schoolers are ushering with us today, so we appreciate that. I love to have the young ones helping out, don't you? Love to see young people that are involved in the work of God. It's more than being drugged to church. We're not a drug church. You're not to drug your kids here. But to be here and to have families worshiping together and have the junior highs up with us the last Sunday of the month so that they can participate. I noticed one on camera is here today, and so we appreciate that involvement. Did you find the book of Acts yet? We're chapter 27. It talks about the Apostle Paul, and as we consider, Lord, I believe, and how that fits for us and how God is actively involved, and then fit that together with what you heard last week with Pastor Harrison and talking about having the mind of Christ. There's one man that really stands out in the Bible, and that's the Apostle Paul. He started off rough, didn't he? He started off as a very religious man who did not have a personal relationship with the living God. He knew the rules, but he didn't know the people. He knew what to do to fight against, but he didn't know what to do to lift people up. And so he started off that way, but then he had a confrontation with Jesus Christ on a road to Damascus one day. Wow, I just pray over in Syria that there's more of those confrontations with Jesus Christ around the Damascus area, troubled area. But I believe God's involved in that as well. Pray for Jerusalem. Pray for the peace of Jerusalem. Every couple of days I'm receiving emails from there on what's happening. And a lot of the things isn't in the mainstream media, but it's a very challenging time. So Paul was a guy that just got turned around. And he taught about having the mind of Christ. He taught about believing in the midst of obstacles and how to be led by Almighty God. You remember, he was led to one place, and then God was leading him to another, and he tried to push this door, but the Holy Spirit said, no, not there, and no, not there. See, the Holy Spirit can say, no, don't do that, as well as he can say, yes, do it. And so today, as we conclude this series on Lord, I Believe, we want to talk about hearing the voice of God. How many love to hear the voice of God? Tell your neighbor, you can do it. You can hear his voice, yep. Just give them a soft elbow. Don't hurt them. Yeah, and you can do it. You can hear the voice of God. And so we want to bring it down to a very challenging time in Paul's life. I know if you've read the book of Acts, you remember he had this desire inside of himself to go to the city of Rome. Why was Rome so significant? It was the capital of the whole Roman Empire. It was where the emperor was. It was where all the Senate was, the leadership. And he had a desire to go there and to share the love of Jesus with those in leadership. And you know, the nice way would be to go in as a glorious, wonderful evangelist. But God had a different plan for him. He went in a different way. But he heard the voice of God. And then all along the way, as he was getting prepared to go, prophet said, don't go, you're going to have trouble. Don't go, you're going to be in jail. You're going to be bound up in prison. Don't go. And he said, I know all that, but that doesn't change what God said. The circumstances around us do not change what God has spoken to us. Amen? And so today we're going to remind you of some of those things. So I'm going to read from Acts chapter 27, around verse number 9 on. And if you remember, they're sailing. He's now a prisoner, and they're sailing along in a nice cruise boat along the Mediterranean. And when we hit verse 9, it says we'd lost a lot of time. The weather was becoming dangerous for sea travel because it was so late in the fall. And so Paul spoke to the ship's officers about it. Now remember, he's a prisoner, and now he's talking to the officers of the ship, and he's saying, men, I believe that there's trouble ahead if we go on. Paul believed, right? He believed because God showed him things. And God showed him there's going to be trouble. So when we believe in God, he can talk to us about a lot of things, can't he? He can even warn us of things in the future. Well, look at how the others saw that. He said, the officer said, but the officer in charge of the prisoners listened more to the ship's captain and to the owner than to Paul. That can happen too. And then it continues on and says, since Fair Havens was an exposed harbor, a poor place to spend the winter, most of the crew wanted to go on to Phoenix, further up the coast of Crete, and spend the winter there. And it was a good harbor with only a southwest and northwest exposure. And then in verse number 13, when a light wind began blowing from the south, the sailors thought they could make it. Have you ever thought you could make it even when God warns you? Maybe not you. Okay, so they pulled up anchor, sailed close to the shore of Crete, but the weather changed abruptly, and a wind of typhoon strength called a nor'easter burst across the island and blew us out to sea. The sailors couldn't turn the ship around in the wind, so they gave up and let it run before the gale. And we sailed along a sheltered side of a small island named Kauda, and there with great difficulty we hoisted aboard the lifeboat that was towed behind us. And then the sailors bound ropes around the hull of the ship to strengthen it. They were afraid of being driven across the sandbars off the coast of North Africa. So they lowered the sea anchor to slow the ship and were driven before the wind. Do you get the picture? Are you visualizing this as we're talking about it? See, the Bible's so good, it paints pictures. Was it a good day for Paul? Was God still with him? Absolutely. And then it says the next day, verse 18, as gale force winds continued to batter the ship, the crew began throwing the cargo overboard. Paul had prophesied that. The following day, they even took some of the ship's gear and threw it overboard. The terrible storm raged for many days, blotting out the sun and the stars until at last all hope was gone. Do you ever feel like that sometimes? Yeah. But Paul believed. He knew that God said, go there. So he didn't look at the circumstances right in front of him, but looked at what God had already spoken and put his focus there. And then it says in verse 21, no one had eaten for a long time, and finally Paul called the crew together. Can you imagine the prisoner calling all the crew together? And he said, men, you should have listened to me in the first place. Wasn't that a nice message to bring? You would have avoided all this damage and loss, but, 22, take courage. None of you will lose your lives, even though the ship will go down. How did he know that? Next verse, 4, last night an angel of the God to whom I belong and whom I serve stood beside me, and he said this, don't be afraid, Paul. What? He knew his name. Don't be afraid, Paul, for you will surely stand trial before Caesar. What's more, God in his goodness has granted safety to everyone sailing with you. Do you think he was praying for that? I think he was. So take courage, for I believe God, it will be just as he said, but we'll be shipwrecked on an island. It all happened. Let's go back to that 25th verse. Can you say it together with me? We have a memory verse. Like we try to commit it to memory, and this is the one for today. Say it together. So take courage, for I believe God, it will be just as he said. One more time. So take courage, for I believe God, it will be just as he said. Amen. Not just talking about Paul, talking about us today.
Yeah. Amen. Because God loves us very much.
Yeah.
Amen. And God wants us to know he knows our name. He knows that he sent Jesus with his love to cover us. And he wants to speak to us today. Just like he spoke to Paul, and Paul knew what to do. He wants to speak to you and I today in the situations of life so that we will know his voice and that we will obey his voice and see his best for our lives come about. You know, when I was growing up, I was known in Brampton as Don's daughter. If I went downtown, I would hear people say, oh, there's Don's daughter. And then I'd be in another group of younger people, and I would be Joy's sister. Oh, that's Joy's little sister. And then after we got married, I became Mrs. Neilson. And then I was applying for my credentials for after Bible school, and I had an interview. And as I was being interviewed, one of the people interviewing me said, oh, that's one of Ron Stevens' girls. Now, Pastor Stevens was my pastor. He was well known in Canada. So all of a sudden, the seal came because I was one of Pastor Stevens' girls. So I was Don's daughter, Joy's sister, Randy's wife, Pastor Stevens' girl. Like, you know, you could begin to wonder who you really are. But you see, the Bible says that God knows my name. And it doesn't matter what anybody else calls me. There was actually a time where I was called Dale for a while. That was Randy's secretary for 20-some years. And people would call me Dale. They'd get us mixed up. You see, it doesn't matter what others say. It doesn't matter what people think. God knows your name.
Yes.
His love is so great for you that no matter what people call you, no matter where you are, no matter how big the wave is in front of you and you can't see the other side, God knows your name. He knows how to call you. He knows how to get your attention. And all we have to do is listen to his voice. Yes. And as we listen to his voice, we can then obey him. If you want to turn in your Bibles to John chapter 10, it says, but the one in verse 2, John 10, 2, but the one who enters through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep recognize his voice and come to him. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. He knows my name. I can hear his voice, and he has always made a way out for me.
Yes.
He is looking for you and I to listen to that voice, to follow his way. It's so simple. Just trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. God is looking for you and I to just obey his voice so he can daily lead us. In Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, many of you are familiar with these verses. It says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. You know, some of you are trying to direct your path from what you know, but God wants you to trust him and let him lead you. You know, years ago, I don't know if they still have them. They used to have bumper stickers. God is my co-pilot. You know, some Christians walk around life like God is the co-pilot. But God is the pilot.
That's right.
He knows where to go.
Yes.
He knows how to get there. He knows the obstacles that you will face. And if you will listen to his voice, he will get you to the other side. So we want to believe and declare and get in our hearts that God knows us. Are you ready to say this declaration with me? Look up to the screen.
Whoops, computer crashed. Oh, there it is.
Okay, here we go. Lord, I believe that you know me personally, by name. You also love me, and I love you. I am ready to hear you speak. And know you are directing my life, regardless of the challenges I face.
That's a good declaration, isn't it? Well, have you had challenges like that? You know, when God speaks something to you, this is the context. When God speaks something to you, and you know he's spoken it to you, what should you do? You should listen and you should receive it, and then you do something about it. Let me tell you a little bit of my story. I discovered this, that your faith in God and then wisdom to cooperate will determine the outcome. It's not just hearing God's voice. And that there may be a time lag between when God speaks and you actually fulfill what he's spoken. So with me, I received Jesus in 1968. Now that's before most of you knew there was a calendar. But that's when I received Jesus as Lord and Savior. And God placed us in a little church in a remote area in Prince Edward Island. And there wasn't much to do. But God gave us friends who were the pastors of the church. And so we spent time together. We ate meals together. We shared life together to the extent that we saw what they went through. We saw the life of what pastor leaders were all about. And we did whatever was necessary to make life easier for them. That was our goal, was what could we do? What needed to be done? Good, I'm here. Let's do it. And then in 1970, on a Sunday night in June, standing at the front of that little church that we just built, it's an old one and we built a new one, I saw a vision of myself standing in front of a large church preaching at the pulpit. And I knew that God was calling me to be actively involved in pastoral ministry. And I said, Lord, I can't be a pastor. I can't sing. And those of you that sit around me, you know that that's still true. But it didn't stop God from fulfilling what he's shown me. And so what do you do? What did I do? Well, what I did is what I did before. I still, because I was in the military, I got transferred from one place to the other. Wherever I was, we were at one church. Committed to that one place, committed to that one group of people, that one pastor. Wherever we were, I observed what they did. We became personal friends with them. We did whatever we could do to lighten their load. I observed, how do they do things? I often asked, help me understand why you do it that way. Help me. And I gained insight. I took Bible correspondence courses throughout that whole time frame for years, actually, because I had a hunger for God's word. I read it and read it and read it and got new Bibles all the time so that I would be refreshed. And I just built myself up, and I did whatever I could do in a local church context to add value, even though I knew there was a calling there. And then in 1980, more than 10 years later, I felt this is now the time has come. And the pastor of the church said, we'd like you to do this job, and you know it'll be your new job. And so I quit my job now as an air traffic controller to go and be there on staff in the church, which I felt was fulfillment of that vision that I'd had. And then rebellion rose up quickly in that church among some of the leaders, and they worked really hard to kick the pastor out and decided that, no, I wouldn't come on staff at the church, even though I'd already quit my job and everything else. And so what do you do when a storm hits like that? Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. It was interesting because God helped us that my heart never got hardened. I still love the people there. Instead, the pastor got kicked out, quit, ran away. Others came in to help out, and we were right alongside of them, working as hard as everybody to keep the congregation together, to encourage them, to build them up, and God was using us to do that, and then he would take care of us.
You know, during that time, some of the leaders came to me, and they said, what's wrong with your husband? And I was like, what's wrong with him? They said, doesn't he know there's problems around here? Why is he so happy all the time? You see, it bothered them that the joy of the Lord was his strength, that the circumstances weren't taking him down, but that he was keeping his attitude sweet. And I can stand here and I can tell you in 47 years of marriage that you have a pastor that says the words that are in his heart, but he will never speak badly of other people. He doesn't talk behind your back. He always speaks truth. If anybody has a weakness, it would be more me than him any day. I'm telling you the truth. He is a man that speaks the word and believes God, even though the circumstances look like it's not changing. Even though the circumstances are rising up against him, he stands for what God says. And for years, I have seen it proven over and over in his life. I believe God above everything else.
Amen.
And we have been blessed because of it.
Thank you. So, but this is where Paul was. That's the way Paul lived.
That's not in the notes.
So this is Paul's life. You know, you run into trials. Does that mean you're not in the middle of God's will? You know, you're promised something, it's not given to you. Does that mean you're not in the middle of God's will?
No.
No, so we just have to keep our hearts sweet and focus on what God has said, but understand that sometimes there's a lag between what God says it and when it's fulfilled. And in between those two things is the walk of faith. And that's what we're called to. We're called to a walk of faith. We're not called to only go by what we see in front of ourselves. And so then 3 years later, in 83, God just spoke so clearly. It was time to go to Bible school. I'd already done all the training before. I'd done the Bible courses before. I'd already taught adults, 100 adults on a Sunday morning and encouraged them. I already led full gospel businessmen chapters and spoken and all the rest of those things. And God said, go to Bible school. And so what do? Praise the Lord. Go to Bible school. And you know, so it was one step at a time. And then it's been, I think in June, it'll be 30 years that we'll be in ministry together. And so you walk with God. But sometimes he gives you a glimpse of things ahead. Don't lose sight. No, he knows your name. He knows who you are. You can hear his voice. You can hear his voice. Tell your neighbor, you can hear his voice. You can. You can hear his voice. He wants you to hear it, and you can follow him. So I think we have another declaration, don't we? Mm-hmm. Let's go to another declaration here. We love to declare what God says. And so I love that scripture, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and follow me. Is God your shepherd? Then you must be his sheep. So then we know his voice. We know and follow him. So let's say it together. Lord, I believe. That you are the good shepherd, and I am your sheep. You lead me, protect me, and love me. Therefore, I will be successful as I follow your leading. Wow.
So God is looking for us to believe him, even when it's difficult. Mm-hmm. Even when it seems like things in our life are being shipwrecked. He's looking for us to believe what his word says. But you see, some of us can't believe because we don't know what the word says. So we have to find out what his word says and understand so that we can understand where he wants to take us. So we can understand what he wants to speak to us. Because as we hide his word in our heart, then he has something to work with, to use when the situations of life come. Many years ago, I was on a flight, and we were going overseas, and I was so fortunate. My nephew had worked for KLM Cargo, and he knew somebody that knew somebody, and I got upgraded to first class. So when you're going on a very long flight, it's a very nice place to be. And I got to the desk, they said, who would you like to come with you? And I'm like, what? Because they don't do that. But they allowed me to pick somebody else. So I picked the head of our prayer at that time and a lady that ran the prayer. And so she came, and the two of us got to sit in first class. And as we were sitting there relaxing, enjoying ourselves with our beds and our feet up and our blankets, and we started talking about what we believed God was speaking for the days ahead. And as we were talking, both of us agreed that we had felt in our hearts that there was going to be turmoil and there was going to be trouble and that we needed to be very wise in what we did. And so we just continued to agree in faith over that flight. And as we landed, that's exactly what happened. Trouble started to brew. The first night after Pastor arrived, they were burning the platform at midnight, and he had to get up and go. And they were trying to break the bus's window so the bus wouldn't work for me anymore. And they were throwing rocks, and we had two platforms, and I was standing at ground level between the two platforms as the policemen in their battle gear were running back, hiding, and instruments were flying through the air from the music platform, and the radicals were trying to take over. And as I stood there, my heart started to speak to me. And it started to speak to me as, is the gospel really worth what you're going through right now? Mm-hmm. Is it really worth this? And as I turned around, I saw the 60 people that I was in charge of, that I was supposed to be looking after. And they're all standing there not knowing what to do. And all of a sudden, something rose up inside of me. And all I could think of is, yes, the gospel is worth it. And I grabbed that policeman that was supposed to be doing something, and I just pulled him for all that was worth. And I said, get out there and do something. It was like something was rising up in me. And I went back and I got our people together and we started praying. And then I started to, you know, do what I needed to do to get them to a safer place and everything else. But the whole point of what I'm trying to say to you is you never know what you believe until you're put in a situation you've never been in before, where you're uncomfortable and things aren't in your control. You have lost all control. And now the only thing you can do is rely on Jesus. You need to know his voice. You need to be able to hear him, because he will speak to you and he will lead you to the right people to get you a bus, to get your people on, to get you to a safe place. He will do what he needs to do on your behalf, because he wants nothing but success for your life.
That's right.
He wants nothing but the very best for your life.
Yes.
But when somebody looks at us wrong, we go hide in the corner. Oh, they don't like me. And we complain. And somebody else gets promoted. Instead of rejoicing with them, we grumble and complain. Well, who do they think they are? Why did they get that? But God wants us to allow his presence to rise up in us so that it doesn't matter what the relationship is, that he will work on our behalf, that he will move on our behalf, because he wants nothing for the best for you.
Amen.
But you see, the world has warped your idea of success. TV has said success looks like this.
Yeah.
Magazines are full of what they think success looks like. But I want to tell you today, true success is trusting and obeying the Lord.
Yes.
Being in the center of God's will for your life.
Yes.
Whatever the center of his will is for you,
yes.
That is true success.
Yes.
So wherever he has called you, I'm thankful for all the university students we have, for the training they're getting, the careers where they can go out and influence the world for Jesus. But I am believing for young people that will rise up to the call of Jesus Christ and that they will give their life to serve him and see him do amazing things through their life. I am believing we live in a day where we need preachers all over the world right now. And I'm believing for that. But the true success for you and I is being in the center of God's will every day, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, the center of God's will for our life, and that will bring true success to each one of us.
So success is not a destination. It's the journey with Jesus. It's walking hand in hand with Jesus. So whether you're young or whether you're not so young, it's staying there, right, Sister Vera? It's staying in the center of God's will. Even when your spouse goes ahead of you, you still stay in the center of God's will for you today.
Yeah.
And you influence the people around you.
Yes.
But context today is hearing the voice of God and believing that God can speak to us. How does God speak to people? Well, we saw with the Apostle Paul, an angel came. How many would like an angel to come and speak to you? Well, in the Bible, when an angel came, it was not a good day. There were big problems coming, and he was coming to let you know that you were able to stand. So please don't pray for angels to come. It's like praying for patience. No, trials bring patience, so don't pray for that. But you know, he started off hearing, well, he had a confrontation for Jesus, obviously, but we can hear God on the inside of our heart. It's often spoken of a still, small voice. And so how could that be? Because every believer has the Holy Spirit living inside you. And so because the Holy Spirit is inside and is God himself, then he can speak to us in a quiet voice that others may not hear. But he can also raise the volume loud enough that he gets our attention. And so God can speak to us in that way. Have you discovered that God can speak to you even through the desires that he puts in your heart? You know, Paul, we talked about his desires that are there. But I think you had a scripture verse on that, didn't you? In Psalm 37, verse 4, it says, if you delight yourself, it's right here.
Delight yourself in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart.
Did you catch the context of that?
Psalm 37:4.
37:4. When you delight yourself in the Lord, he places desires within you, mm-hmm. And then he works to fulfill those desires as well. But the focus is that we delight ourselves in the Lord. We don't come to church on a Sunday to worship together because we have to. We're not here just because it's that time of day. We delight in the Lord, and we want to spend time together corporately to honor him and worship him. But we do it at home as well, and we honor God there, and we spend time with him. And as we do, he wakes desires up. Let me give you an example of how this happened with me. Many years ago, back in the 70s, I had a desire to build things. How many boys like to build things? My boys always like to break them, to take them apart. And whenever I tried it, I always had a couple pieces left over.
So did they.
So did they. Yeah, but they still ran. So anyway, and so we moved to a city, and even though we had a brand new house that we'd only lived in a very short time, we bought a big old house built in 1913 that was kind of an estate home of one of the members of the first Alberta legislature owned this house. So it had historical value. And it was a mess. In fact, it had been on the real estate market for over a year, and we were the first. I was the first person. Jill didn't come the first time. I was the first person that got by the door. The smell stopped them.
The realtor said she couldn't believe he actually went in.
So I went in and put an offer on it.
Before I saw it.
Contingent on her seeing it, of course. We always are in one accord. But we bought the house and stripped it out right down to the bare bones, and then I built it back up again. And all the rest of it. And it became a beautiful house that is still standing as a heritage home in that city. But after that, the community around it kind of changed. And so I felt, no, I want to build a house. And so I looked around, and it was really busy at that time in that community. There were no lots available. It's like here, you know, it's hard for you to go buy a lot because the builders have them. There, the builders had them all and used them all. And driving around, I saw one lonely lot in the middle of a cul-de-sac, empty. So I went to the city and said, I want to buy it. They said, no, you don't. It's already two of the biggest builders have bought it and sent it back to us because it's got a water problem. It's got a little fountain in the middle of it underground. And so as soon as I heard that, a scripture verse rose up inside of me, and it came out of the Old Testament, 2 Chronicles 7:14. How many know what that scripture verse said? If my people, I was, who are called by my name, I was, will humble themselves, I was going to, and obey my voice, right? And how does it continue? Is it up there? Nope, it's not up there. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and
heal their land.
And that's all I heard. And heal their land. And he's going to heal that piece of ground in that city, and I'm going to build a house. So I bought it and built the house on it.
After you walked around praying.
Oh, I stood.
Reading your Bible.
The first thing I did was after we bought it, I went and took my big King James Bible at the time and stand with houses on both sides and people looking through the windows and read 2 Chronicles 7:14 to the ground and boldly declared that I was standing on this word of God. God spoke to me through that word that was out of context, but it was applicable to that specific situation. And if you study Greek language, you know logos is the word of God that's there and it's written as for us to enjoy. But rhema is the one that's God-breathed and just explodes and comes alive and takes action. And that logos became rhema to me, and I spoke it. So I'm not telling you to do this. I'm telling you my story. And so we built on it. And I think I've mentioned this before. When we were almost finished the house, we'd gone on vacation and came back, and we stopped for gas 3 hours away and saw the front page of the newspaper showing our community with somebody in a canoe paddling down the road, the street in our community where our house was built. What do you do then? Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. We drove home, and immediately I went down the basement, and it was dry, and I went to where we dug a hole for a sump and opened the sump up, and it was totally dry as well. God had healed our land, and it was totally. So I'm just saying, God can speak to you through the Word of God. He can put desires inside of you. He can speak by his still, small voice. He can use an angel, but don't ask for that. He can bring prophetic people around you. You maybe on a Sunday morning like this where you hear that all things are possible through Jesus Christ. And it's just what you need for your situation. Maybe God speaks to you a specific word that Jill or I share or others share. And wow, that's what you need. And God is speaking to you. So God will speak to you because he loves you and wants to change our situation around. So that verse, could we put that memory verse up there again, please, friends? And where is it? So take courage. 25, that's it. So take courage. For I believe God.
It will be just as he said.
Even in difficult times. Go ahead, you talk about that.
The world wants you to think you just have to go along with the way things are. But God said, listen to my voice. Obey what I say. And let me lead you day by day. He wants to lead us in everything we do. But so often we think we have to do it ourselves. And, you know, some of us have tried it ourselves and we've kind of messed it up. But God is there and he's reaching out to us today. And he's saying, if you will listen to my voice, if you will follow in what I say, I will bring to you more than you ever dreamed. I will bless your life in a way you could never understand. He is such a loving God. His love is so great for you. But fear always holds us back. Fear always tries to rise up and say, well, what if? What if that doesn't happen? What if it doesn't work for you? Well, you're not them. But you see, God's love wants to surround you. He wants to come. And let his love be so strong in us that we fall so in love with Jesus that love becomes a protective coat around us. It shields us. And as fear tries to come, that love pushes back that fear from you and I. And we don't have to receive the fear because his love is what holds us. His love keeps us. His love is a platform on which we can stand. And we never have to worry about sinking. Because he will always hold us up. Whatever we need, his love will be there to protect us. Yes. It will be there to take us through whatever we have to go through. A few weeks ago, I had several of you were praying for Peter Pretorius in Africa. And things weren't good. His heart was out of his body for several hours, and things weren't going well. And then, miraculously, God just turned things around. And then a week later, it just went down again, and we thought we were losing him. And God just came and breathed his life into him again. And I'm telling you today that on Wednesday, he was released from the hospital. The cardiologist is calling him the miracle man. And he is home because the cardiologist said, we didn't know what else to do. We'd done everything we could. And it wasn't looking good. But you see, God wasn't done with Peter yet. God still has more for him to do. So he's breathed his life back into him. See, we look and we see what's in front of us. And fear tries to come. But when we look to what God says, and if all you can say is, Lord, I believe you. Then say that. Declare what God says. Don't let fear come out of your mouth. Don't let the words that will stop you from moving ahead in what God has hold you back. because our words are powerful. And when we speak the life of God, then the life of God opens things in front of us. But when we speak negative thoughts and we speak negative things around, it closes the door in front of us. And God wants to open his life unto each and every one of us because he loves us so much. And he wants those desires he's placed in your heart to come about. So he wants his life to flow.
Yes.
So take courage today. For Lord, I believe that what you said is going to come about.
Yeah. Praise God. We have one more declaration together. Because I believe there are many in this place that are in the middle of life's storms. And so we just want to declare what we believe here. So can we say it together? Lord, I believe. That whatever challenges come my way, that you are leading me through them, and I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. Amen. Can we just start to pray now? Father, I just thank you for everyone here today. I thank you, Lord, for your presence in this place. You knew who would be here. You knew who would be watching over the internet. You knew what their desires, You knew what the challenges of life are that people are going through. And so, Lord, we stand together with them. Friend, you're not alone. We join our faith with you. We join our courage with yours. When you are weak, he is strong within you. He is helping you. He is helping you be strengthened day by day by day. So friends, let me do it this way. Just quietly, okay? If you're going through a real challenge in life, you feel you're in a storm, would you just stand on your feet right here? We just want to join our faith with you. I don't want to embarrass anyone. I'm not going to ask you to come forward. But it's an expression of faith. And I know there's some that storm is in the health areas. Some it's in employment and financial areas. But God is greater than all of these things. Some is in relational. God just spoke to me about that. So would you lift your hands with me and say, Lord, I believe. Just tell him, Lord, I believe. Lord, I believe that you're able.
Lord, I believe.
To do beyond what I can even imagine. To restore. To change. To bring about your will in my life and those around me. So, Father, I join my faith with these dear ones. I speak health and healing to bodies. Strength into situations. The will of God, let it be done in each and every one of their lives now in the name of Jesus. And Lord, if there's any that need to surrender their life to you, let them do so even now. Just cry out, say, Lord, I surrender. I surrender my will to you. I surrender my desires to you. I surrender my heart to you, Jesus. Help me, fill me, change me from the inside out. Just ask him. And he will turn your life around. Lord, bring your power to bear, your life to bear in every situation, we pray. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Praise God. You can sit down. Thank you. So we stand with you. Regardless of the challenges of life, never feel embarrassed if you go through difficult times. But don't let it get you down. Jesus is lifting you up. Focus on him. Maybe you've seen the little plaque with the footsteps, that footsteps poem. I thought you'd abandon me when I could only see one set of footsteps. It was because I was holding you up. Jesus is here to help us. On the back of your connection card, pull it out. There's space. Make sure the front is filled in, but go to the back side there. It talks about things. Commit that verse to memory and then boldly do what God speaks to you. And then ask God to speak to those around you. Speak to your family members. Let him speak. If they're believers, he can speak loud enough to get their attention. If they're not, he can still touch their lives to turn them around. Jesus loves you. Would you put your hands together for Pastor Reed as he comes, please? Thank you, brother.
Thank you, Pastor Randy. Also, just continuing on the connection card, the next steps you've looked at, there is another section. If you accept Jesus Christ as Lord, as the Lord of your life today, please indicate that on the card. And even while they were praying for people who are having challenges, maybe you said, Lord, I accepted you once. And I turned away from you, O Lord, but I want to rededicate my life to you. Please indicate that on the connection card as well. Fall Fest is coming up on October 31st. If you're willing to serve in that capacity, in that area, please indicate that on the card. If you need prayer, please indicate your prayer request on the card. And if you also need a home visit, please do that as well. Indicate that on the card. And when you're leaving, please hand the card to the usher there. If this is your first time at BCF, please come and join us at the Welcome Center. Bring your connection card with you. We have a gift there for you. And if over the past month of October, starting even in September, if you started attending BCF, you say, I want BCF Church to be the place I want to worship, please come and visit with us there. We also have a gift for you. We're giving away things today. So come and join us there. Some of the leaders will be there to meet with you. The giving kiosk will be open as soon as the service ends as well. And the women, the Reveal Conference is coming up. Please register. Oh, let me say that again. The Reveal Conference is coming up. Women, please register. You can register. Not you, Pastor Dr. Harrison. Yeah, please register at the kiosk there. And men, we would like to your assistance just after, before we leave, to take the stage down and the chairs as well. Would you stand so I can pray a blessing upon you? Our Father, we thank you for what we have received from you today. And we thank you, O God, that we can boldly declare that we believe in what you have said about our lives. And as we go not from your presence, but we go with your blessing. Because you promise us, Lord, that your goodness and your mercies will follow us all the days of our lives. So we thank you, O God, for empowering us and strengthening us today and this week so that we can accomplish your will in our lives. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. God bless you.